Hi friends, now we'll see norma basalis, that is the basal view of the skull. In the previous videos we have discussed about the frontal view, vertical view, lateral view, where you have discussed different features and attachments. Today we'll discuss about the norma basalis. Norma basalis is divided into three parts, that is from the anterior margin of the alveolar arch to the posterior margin is anterior part. From the posterior margin of the alveolar arch to the line passing in front of the foramen magnum is the middle part, and whatever the behind the line passing in front of the anterior margin of foramen magnum is posterior part. And coming to the bones of the norma basalis, when you explore the skull, the different bones you can visualize here. Anteriorly you will see maxillary bone and pair of palatine bone, and midline omer bone is there. And on either side of the omer, you are seeing the girder wing of sphenoid, body of sphenoid, and temporal bones, and lastly, occipital bone. So here you have seen sphenoid, omer, and occipital are unpaired, whereas you can see pair of maxillae, pair of palatine bone, and pair of temporal bones. So these are the bones you appreciate in the norma basalis. And when you hold the skull in anatomical position, the anterior part lies at lower level than the other parts. So the base of the skull is divided into three parts: anterior, middle, and posterior, by two imaginary lines. One line is passing behind the posterior margin of hard palate, and one line is passing in front of the anterior margin of foramen magnum. You can see laterally, you will see the bones. Maxillae, zygomatic comes in normal lateralis, you can see temporal bone and guttering of sphenoid and occipital bone. So here we are seeing the basal view, but we are describing it in anatomical position. That is the difference here, describing as if it is in the anatomical position, but we are holding it in basal view. So there should not be any confusion regarding the description attachments, above or below, below or above. So coming to the anterior part, as I told you, anterior part is from the alveolar arches to the posterior margin of hard palate. You can see, you will see the two features in the anterior part. You will see horseshoe shaped alveolar arch with the socket for the tooth, and it is enclosing the arch of bony palate, that is a hard palate. It is anteroposteriorly, it is arched. And you will see it is presents posterior free border, whereas bony palate is formed by the palatine process of maxilla and a horizontal process of palatine bone held by sutures. You can see here that is the palatine process of maxilla from both sides, and posteriorly you will see a horizontal process of palatine bone. They are held by a cruciform suture. You can visualize in your dry skull. Please hold dry skull in your hand in basal view. You can see the cruciform suture there, that is part of the maxilla bone, what you are appreciating. And behind you will see palatine. Maxilla forms the 3/4 of the palate, palatine forms the posterior 1/4, and you will see the palatine bone presents a free border. The posterior free border is crescentic with a midline projection called as posterior nasal spine. And on either side of posterior nasal spine, you will see crescentic margins, that is called as palatine crust. Whereas posterior nasal spine gives attachment to the muscle of the soft palate called as musculus uvulae. The posterior crescentic margin presents a palatine crust anterior to the margin. And this palatine crust gives attachment to palatine aponeurosis. If you zoom it and see here, you will see a crest in front of that crescentic margin, that is called as palatine crest, giving attachment to the palatine aponeurosis, modified tendon of tensor valli palatini muscle. Soft palate is attaching here. This is palatine aponeurosis, a flattened tendon of tensor valli palati to which other muscles are attached. So that is about the bony palate, and you will see two openings here. One is a greater palatine foramen, affecting the palatine bone medial to the third molar tooth. You can see there greater palatine foramina transmits greater palatine neuron vessels. Greater palatine artery is a branch of third part of maxillary artery. Greater palatine nerve come from tragopalatine ganglion and lesser palatine foramina, pair of lesser palatine foramina affecting the pyramidal process of palatine bone just behind the third molar tooth. And lesser palatine foramina transmits same named nerves and vessels. You can appreciate here, these are the features what you see in anterior part of normal basalis, that is greater palatine foramina, and you will see pair of lesser palatine foramina. They are paired and pass the same named nerves and vessels. So as you go just behind the incisors, the hard palate shows there incisive fossa, a cone shaped fossa, incisive fossa, that is the incisive fossa just behind the incisor teeth. You can see the incisive fossa there, and this incisive fossa presents incisive foramina in the lateral wall of it. It is in line with the intermaxillary suture. You can see there on either side presents the lateral incisive foramina transmitting the long nasopalatine vessels from above, and continuation of greater palatine vessels from below. And usually sometimes it presents anterior and posterior incisive foramina. In that case, the anterior passes the long nasopalatine and posterior passes the other structures related to this palate. So this is about the incisive fossa, and sometimes you will see a separate bone in front of the maxilla that is called as premaxilla. The suture passes between the incisors and canines there on either side from intermaxillary suture. That portion is called as premaxilla. And in the hard palate, you will see several indentations formed by the palatine glands there. And this is the horseshoe shaped alveolar arch presenting the socket for the tooth. As example of gomphosis, peg and socket joint. So these are the different bones what you see here in the anterior part of norma basalis. Frontal part is there in the norma frontalis, but here you will see pair of maxilla and a pair of palatine bones. Pair of maxilla, pair of palatine bones. So this is about the anterior part of the norma basalis. Now we will see the attachments. You will see that is the anterior part, alveolar arch, and you will see arch of a bony palate found by pair of palatine process of maxilla and pair of horizontal process of palatine bone. And you will see posterior free margin of the hard palate presenting a posterior nasal spine and a posterior crescentic margin and palatine crest. And you will see incisive fossa, and on either side of the palatine bone you will see greater palatine foramina and lesser palatine foramina. So coming to the structures passing through the greater palatine foramina, you will see the palatine bone there with the greater palatine foramina transmitting same named nerves and vessels. You can see there how they reach the palate, and just behind the greater palatine foramina you will see pair of lesser palatine foramina. So greater palatine and lesser palatine, they transmit the same named nerves and vessels. Now coming to the muscular attachments, you can see that is the musculus uvulae attached to the posterior nasal spine, and that is tensor velae palati coming from there forming the upper neurosis attached to the palatine crest. You can see now these are all are the muscles of the soft palate. This is musculus uvulae, a median muscle, that is the tensor velae palati and levator velae palati coming from above the middle part of the base of the skull, whereas below there are two muscles, palatoglossus and palatopharyngeus. Remember, the all the muscles attached to the palatine aponeurosis, attached to the palatine crest, musculus will attach to the posterior nasal spine, and palatine aponeurosis is the flattened tendon of tensor veli palatii.